So this is organized under the auspices of the IEEE Solid State Circuit Society, UK and Ireland chapter. For those who don't know me, I'm Peter Kennedy and I'm the chair of the chapter. The program, we've had a number of events, starting in Limerick, Cork, again in Cork. We had Mike Flynn before Christmas, Dave Murphy. We had a short course in undergraduate IC design in January. We had a workshop a couple of weeks ago in Limerick on VCOs. Today we have the mini workshop on low power radio for the Internet of Everything by Sven Mattisson. And then starting in April we'll have a lecture by Patrick Raynard, also in the area of RF. And so everybody knows we're bidding to host S-Circ Esder in Ireland in 2019. So it's a big item for us. Today we have our wonderful talk on our talks on low-power radio for the Internet of Everything. First part is an introduction to Bluetooth, then we have a little break of tea and coffee in the back, and then we have a piece moving it all on to 5G. So for technical reasons, you all need to sign the attendance sheet. Those of you who pre-registered, your names are pre-printed and just sign IEEE member and all. Those of you who haven't pre-registered, fill in your name and email address and membership, please. Okay, so today's talk, Low Power Radio for the Internet of Everything, by Sven Mattisson of Ericsson Research Sweden. This is one of the nicest people you can meet, but also one of the most accomplished. For those who don't know, is one of the co-inventors of Bluetooth. Everybody in the room, everybody we know has Bluetooth, uses it all the time. And it's a great honor that he is here to share his thoughts on that today. He's also heavily involved in 5G and the standards associated with that and all the technical developments. And he gives his insights into what the future holds for us as well. So with that, I present
Thank you, Peter. Very nice and flattering introduction. It's a pleasure being here. I arrived yesterday evening and weather improved from where I left. So, my presentation will be almost in three parts, although it's advertised for two parts. The first half of the first part will be more on Bluetooth and our thoughts and development of early development of Bluetooth. Then I will dig into more into hardcore, if you will, circuit design in metrics for radios, power consumption, etc., and innovations. Then there's a break, and then I will go through more 5G, cover standardization where we're at, and also show some experiments that and the university involved. And if you feel like interrupting, please do. That way I can tell you things you want to know. And I will not say things I think you know, but no one's really interested. So, without further ado, Bluetooth started in the city of Lund in the mid 90s. Now, where is Lund? I should have a map, but Lund is a bit like Cork, I would say. It's a pretty old town. It's a large university. These pictures are copyrighted by myself, so they're okay to show. There's a university building and a cathedral, and the sun is always shining, and the blue sky, except yesterday when it was snowing. Anyway, this what I want to say, this is a place much like any university where you have a mix of high-tech industry and research. And that means we have lots of people with different skill sets cooperating, and you can do something interesting. And Lund is in the very south of Sweden, you can say just outside Copenhagen. Side of the bridge, those who you have seen that in the boils down to Moore's law. Moore's law is more like an observation rather than perhaps a law. But that, whatever that is driving our business. Pictures are not important as such. It's just to recognize that we have had exponential growth for a very long time. And Moore's law, the extrapolation there starts 1971 with a doubling of capacity. Actually, Moore's law, the original one, had two slopes, one for memory and one for random logic, but we usually simplify and say that the number of devices double every other year. But that's also applicable to the number of flops, floating point operations per second. And the flops start, it's hard to say, but 1900, so that was well before microelectronics. But you do see microelectronics entering the picture with the bend in the slope, so exponential growth increased. Now this is all hardware, of course, and for those of you with sharp eyes can see there is also Wirth's law. Wirth, the professor from Switzerland, famous for Pascal language, among other things, and he's claimed to have said software is getting slower more rapidly than hardware becomes faster. So we are best at constant speed with our computers. All jokes aside, the exponential growth is really a powerful thing, and this means that if you're not thinking ahead of time, what can you I do in 5 years? You will be left standing beside of the road, because you tend to think linear, and development times are more. That's another interesting law, Cooper's law, the Motorola manager, also starting actually with the first radio transmission ever. And that's also exponential growth for more than 100 years, counting as the conversations per area, or radio transmissions per area. And there is no reason to assume that this will slow down. Now, what can we do? And I guess our answer in here is Internet of Things or Internet of Everything, because we can't just make cellular calls between people and meet these numbers. So this is a huge area. And of course, not as perhaps well formulated with slide as at least that I've done now, we had objectives for Bluetooth in Ericsson. I said it started in mid-90s. In fact, it started 94 in the fall, when the idea of making a wireless cable surface I'm actually not honestly quite sure who came up with the idea, but we started working, looking into what frequency bands to use, what access method, etc. And that was done actually before I joined Ericsson. I joined in January 95, and my task was to be object leader for seeing this happen. So I used to be a professor at university, so what do you do with a university professor in industry? You put him somewhere safe where he can't get something with the things. And that's how I felt in the beginning, at least, because core business was handsets. Anyway, so cable between, and it was supposed to be an accessory to the handset. So we didn't want 2 kilometers of cable. We didn't want 10 centimeters either. So also 10 meter-ish. And that's a very powerful requirement to have, to know what you want to do, even if you have no clue how to do it. But knowing what you want to do, that's very key to come up with the business. Because if you know that, you also know that someone wants you to do it and wants the result. So it's not like open-ended innovation. So this is one of my first slides from Ericsson, early Ericsson days, with a project office. So we were we're shipping for low volume. This is not low production volume, but physical volume. We wanted to put this in a handset. It should not add significantly to the cost. It should not add significantly to the power consumption. And of course, not the size either. But it should do its thing. It should be as good as a cable, except that it shouldn't sit. And the good thing is, well, you can do something that is not obtrusive. It's not in your way. It sort of works. Now, of course, in the early days, maybe it wasn't the smooth sailing all the time, but that's sort of the general idea. And we opted for, we need to be safe and robust. So our challenges then, of course, was to make an efficient link, yet robust. I'll mention more about that later on. And we all quickly realized, based on Moore's law, that this has to be one chip radio. No external filters, or IF filters, because RF roofing filters, we did not think we could get away with any interference. No external detector components and many other donors. And this was formulated spring 95. Looking into receiver architectures, what options did we have at the time? Double conversion or dual conversion was the norm for handsets and many other high-performance radios. You have at least two mixers. You have IF filters and image filters, because the mixer is of course sensitive to both the wanted signal and the image response at two IF frequencies away. And you need to suppress both noise and potential signals. And if you do that right, your IF frequency should be pretty high. Otherwise, you will have a problem with the image. But if it's too high, you have a problem with the filter bandwidth. So you ended up with at least dual conversion, but really high performance or triple conversion. Now, we were shooting for a cable replacement, so we didn't want all that performance. And certainly, we could not afford such a complex design. So we were looking into single conversion. And single conversion should be understood as when you have just one set of mixers. Here I have shown quadrature mixers. They are mixing the same LO frequency but different phases. Down to, in a zero IF case, you down convert directly to baseband. As a low IF option, when you down convert to a small number of RF bandwidths. If you have 1 megahertz channel bandwidth, you could down convert to 0.5 megahertz, or as we actually chose to do in the first design, to 3 megahertz, a low number. That gives you some advantages, but a lot of problems. You have an in-band image, which means you cannot filter it any longer. But you do not have need external bandpass filters. And also the designs existing at the time, they were like triple chip sets with gallium arsenide mixed with bipolar mixed with CMOS. We needed something that was compatible with a single technology. And in the first design, we opted for bi-CMOS. So our solution to this set of problems was to look at the 2.4 gigahertz band, which was almost globally available at the time. It's kind of funny that in France, the military occupied a small part of the band, and eventually we convinced them to yield. So we won over the French. And also Japan has special rules. So technically it's not a problem to carve out a hole in a band, but how do you enforce that people actually follow the rules? So it was very good. And of course, this was paved also by Wi-Fi existing at the time. As I mentioned, we wanted to do signal conversion to minimize the RF complexity, but also to minimize power. If you look at the power budget for a gigahertz or above receiver, LO distribution is a key contributor to the net power consumption, just running the wires around. So the fewer such circuits and the less time it's turned on, the better. We opted for low IF because then we could use active bandpass filters. We started out with designing with GMC filters based on the Nauta generator cell. Other options were possible, but that's what we do. But then we got the problem of an inbound image. Maybe I should back the tape a bit and say the 2.4 GHz band is 83-ish megahertz wide, starting at 2.4 GHz. And there are various regulatory requirements on that band. If we want, you want to go basically above 0 dBm, you have to fulfill one of the set of regulations existing. And one was to divide this band into 79 1 MHz channels, the extra space is used for guard bands. And that's what we intended to do. So our image, if we have a low IF, would fall inbound, and someone else might use that. Problem is, someone else might not use Bluetooth, but be a double magnetron microwave oven. The microwave oven, the center frequency of the magnetron is not stable. It whittles, and then it stables when it reaches more thermal equilibrium. If you have more professional, they have two magnetrons, so you have strong interference with unpredictable behavior. And of course, then there's also Wi-Fi, and that has also unpredictable behavior. I think as a Bluetooth guy. Anyway, so we needed to deal with the inbound image. And we decided to use frequency hopping to avoid that. And that was part of the FCC rules for this band, that if you wanted high power, you need to spread the spectrum. And frequency hopping was a very nice way of doing it, because we could make a narrow band receiver, and yet a wide band that spread spectrum. So we could use narrow band techniques. Then there would be some jamming, but no static. And if I recall right, we estimated with just 20 dBs of image reaction from the quadruple mixing, we would lose at most 5% capacity of the cell. So from a regulatory point of view, this is very bad if you think statically, because someone ends up with that bad channel, but now it's spread out, so you don't notice. And one key ingredient in our work here was also, of course, to we needed a low cost, we needed a widespread adaptation of this, so cost. And if you have too tough requirements, then you counteract that. So we wanted just the right level of requirements to solve our problem, the wireless cable replacement of 10 meter length. If industry can do better, well, then they do that eventually, because that's a competitive advantage. And today, the sensitivity, I think we had more or less a 20 dB noise figure specified, and that was pointed at. But we didn't know how much on-chip interference would there be if you're making a completely integrated system. So we figured out it's good enough. The system will do its thing. And then in the end of the day, it turned out to be a non-issue. But anyway, so by using on-chip filters, that opens up for automatic tuning. We tune the GMC filters by changing their supply voltage. making a small PLL with a GMC resonator as a VCO lock to the crystals, and these were very accurately tuned in the background continuously. In fact, the first design was transferred from one fab to another, and the bipolar stuff stopped working, but this GMC filter worked. Even though it turned out that modeling was wrong for the capacitance in the moderate inversion rate. I mean, this is 20 years ago. So that automatic tuning saved us because we had enough margin, and that turned out to model apps. The image rate mixing, as I mentioned, that was the 5% we could suppress. We did. We assumed 35 dB, but we didn't want to specify more than 20 dB of image reaction for that was good enough. TDD was key to us. Most cellular was FDD, of course, because then you can, in principle, you have more flexibility in scheduling and you get more capacity. But TDD relaxes the isolation on chip, so we don't need to run the transmitter and the receiver at the same time. You don't need a duplexer. A duplexer is a complicated bandpass filter between the antenna and the transceiver, separating the receive and transmit signal from each other. We just needed a switch, which fairly soon actually became integrated into the chipset. And there was no need to generate two LOs, only the one with a single synthesizer. We integrated the VCO. We figured out that bond wire tolerances were good enough. So to get a better Q, we used bond wires and on-chip reactors. And we just opened with that frequency was controlled by IP11, and we just opened the loop and wiggled the variable cap for phase modulation. And that worked very well. For quite some time, we had to make sure there were no leakage. And in the end, it was the ESD protection that set the leakage. Of course, it was a solution that was somewhat short-lived because with more flexibility, longer package, eventually the leakage would be a problem. And also, EVM is more difficult to control. But that was a very simple solution, giving a very clean transmit spectrum to very high efficiency. And the PA was then integrated. Now, PA is perhaps a strong word for a 0 dBm output, but it was all there. So basically, the antenna, and in the first version also, the RF filter, carving out the RSM. So here's the first link budget from my kids' switchpad. Well, we used the Lucent by CMOS technology. We started doing work with cubic technology, but that only had an FT of 12 gigahertz, so it was kind of difficult to make useful circuitry at 2.4. So we were looking into Lucent had the MBIC 3 technology at the time. An FT of 18 gigahertz and half micron CMOS. The Philips was 1 micron CMOS. So that was the technology we used. So this is some kind of problem solving, I think. Understanding the problem of the solution. We avoided trade-offs like optimization. We're trying to come up with new ways of isolating the problems like frequency hopping. And I think the last bullet, stamina, is essential. It helps if you're smart enough, but there's nothing replacing stamina. So this is another picture, also what we thought would be. This is around launch time 98. small module with a polished part, that's the RF transceiver, single chip. The off-chip components are basically, actually the loop filter, because we chickened out there, we didn't think we could have low enough interference level on chip for the PLL loop filter. But otherwise it's just decoupling. And then the module put into the lowest in CAN also includes the processor. So it was like a computer interface in one end and an antenna in the other. This is a key performance number, version 1.0. We had a 100 meter option, I've talked about 10 meter, but that needed an extra PA. And we also included in the standard that for the high power versions, if you have a good single strength, if you receive a good single strength, you're not allowed to transmit higher just to boost SNR at the receiver. It's like in a bar. I hate when they have music in the background because that means you need to yell to be heard and you get a sore throat regardless of what you drink. Now we were trying to push down the noise level down, and if you're too far away, you're too far away. Or if you're jammed, you're jammed. But that also helps cars. It was 1 megabit per symbol, per second symbol rate in the air interface. But we supported up to 721 plus 56 kilobits per second asymmetric data. And lots of features. And we also hinted, this is an old slide by the way, that the high-speed variant is in development. That has been in development for a very long time, but what's taking off now is actually a lower speed, longer range. These were some concepts we discussed around 2000. In the upper left corner you see handsets with Bluetooth built in and the Bluetooth headset. And to the right you see something we call the surfboard. It's really an iPad, if you want, with a web browser and then Bluetooth connecting from the surfboard to the access point on the lower left, which then sits on the fixed net. And there is a fancy phone, I think actually that's the one who was featured in the James Bond movie. It's fake, of course. Sales forecast is kind of interesting to look at. We think linearly. So you think, now we have traction, now we're going. And then everyone is saying, it's going too slow, nothing is happening. And then you more or less give up, and then boom, it comes. It's an exponential thing. So it's more of the time point rather than the volumes, because you can get whatever volumes within reason you want by just waiting or changing the timing. By 2006, more than 1 billion units total have been sold, and 8 years from the start, 1.7, and that was 8 years from the start, and 1.7 billion 2011. And only this year it's estimated to be 4 billion. So what made all this possible? Well, co-design system and hardware, I think, is key. We tailor the specification for cost and efficiency. We weren't trying to be better than needed. Of course, we had a clear target of single chip. There were some good user scenarios. People were actually willing to pay to solve. And we had good competence within a convenient range. There were many other. This is Lund-centric, of course. Surprise, but I mean, combination of good research, good business thinking, some backing, you could put it so. And today, I think it's version 4, the low energy, that is the dominating that's backwards compatible. They have basically increased the modulation index, changed the channel space, and regulatory requirements are not exactly the same as we had in the beginning. But those were things actually we looked into already in 96, but we decided we don't have the manpower to address them. So it's sort of just tweaking the parameters a bit to address another need. Yeah, I won't bore you with the volumes, but it's a sign of sort of the winner takes it all. There were other technologies, I'm sure they were more or less equally good, but they didn't have the right few details that made a difference. I skipped this one. So now moving on a bit to more modern times and highlighting the exponential growth. I mean, you remember Cooper's law, wireless capacity doubles every 30 months. So if you draw this in a linear scale, you have, you see the hockey stick, exponential growth. And we are now predicting 50 billion connected devices in just a few years' time. And that's the Internet of Things. So now I will be, round off this Bluetooth. We went from just a simple cable replacement, and now with the Internet of Things and the time in between Bluetooth and now, we have seen a lot of growth in wireless communication used for much more than just voice conversations. This is a picture I borrowed from Professor Jan Rabayo of the Berkeley University. He calls it the swarm. If you look in the center, there you have the cloud or the where the computing takes place, and the gray circle around the cloud, that is the access layer, like cellular infrastructure, Wi-Fi infrastructure. And the new thing where we grow, that's the swarm. They have a swarm lab, that's why they call it the swarm or the cloud. That's, you know, that's where you have all these machine-to-machine applications, NFC, what have you. And it's very hard to imagine exactly what will be done, but I think what will happen here is you will, if you want to build something Internet of Thingy, the good thing with this model is that you only have to find a way into the cloud. You don't have to find a way out to the other end. Someone else might do that for you, which lowers the incentive and problems of getting started. So now I will speed up a bit and be more technical, so some of you might think this is not so fun, but I wanted to show what is driving the complexity of this. And the short story, for those who are not interested in the details, is dynamic range and bandwidth. For the RF, you get the bandwidth almost for free. So for us, hopping over 80 megahertz was not a big deal. It was getting to 2.4 gigahertz that was the problem. So LNAs, they are usually wideband enough. But for the IF, then it's a relative bandwidth that is key. That's why the low IF is so interesting, because the relative bandwidth is lower. Larger, if you take the center frequency over the bandwidth. That ratio should be as... now I mixed it up. You should have a... The bandwidth is usually fixed, so you should have as low an intermediate frequency as possible, because then the bandpass filters become almost low-pass filters and they consume the minimum amount of power. If you have a very high IF, you must make very high Q filters, and current consumption grows, depending a bit on how you build, but can grow contractively with the ratio of But for all blocks, it's dynamic range. Looking into an LNA to prove the point, and this is formulas are taken to some extent from Tom Lee's book, which is very good. But anyway, you could think of the noise level of the device more or less like the equivalent noise of the resistor. Comparable to G, and of course that will be biased noise and whatnot, but that's a rule of thumb, a resistor equal to 1 over GM. And the GM you get for current is more or less fixed if you're a bipolar or subthreshold guy. If you're working moderate or strong inversion in MOS, you have some leverage. But basically that's a fixed relation between current and GM. And that boils down to noise, because the noise is usually compared to 50 ohms for practical reasons. So you can say that the current consumption of an LNA will be 5 milliamps over the noise factor minus 1. You can, or the noise figure, you could also estimate that to be 1. Log 10 or 1 plus 1.2 of GMR. So to make a low noise amplifier, you need to crank up the GM much more than ours that drives the current. And the compression point will be given either by the output clipping or the ID over GM. So these are pretty fixed numbers. You can't do very much about that. Dynamic range, you can then see as compression point over noise, and you can see that then relates to power consumption as well. So if you want to do a new Bluetooth, my advice is to don't stress the noise filter too much. Now this is the intrinsic, and of course you have other things adding. You can apply similar reasoning on other blocks. You're all familiar with the band-limited noise, KT over C noise. That's a very nice way of coupling capacitor size to thermal noise voltage. If you know the thermal noise voltage, then you know how big a capacitor you need. And you can figure out what current you need to drive it, etc. For filters, that's critical. I have a somewhat contrived example here, where we studied at Ericsson in Lund the early LTE days. Co-location of GSM close to the bandage of LTE. Can we make a filter that suppresses the GSM? So we looked at this elliptic prototype, and the study was, is this actually feasible to build in an industrial context? Turns out that the complexity of a filter is proportional to the normalized coefficient sum. So you can actually compare two filters by just looking in. For old guys, it's Zverev handbook. For newer guys, you do MATLAB and you get the normalized coefficients. You just sum them up and take the ratio. The sum is the size, the ratio is the difficulty. Smallest and biggest. Without going into detail, this could be a ladder implementation. Well, all the reactive components, inductors and capacitors are emulated by integrators, and one op-amp in this case for every state in the filter. So the zeros are not states, so you don't need an op-amp. So by just looking at the coefficient sums, you can do lots of calculations. The intention was not for you to grasp all this, but just so there is a connection between that. And once you know the coefficients, you implement them as capacitors, you know your noise floor, then you know the size of the capacitors, you know the dynamic range, then you know how strongest signal you need to drive through the pass though, then you know the current, then you know the supply voltage, and you know your power consumption. And then there's that beautiful formula down there, connecting IED with filter bandwidth and topology. So you can very easily compare, should I do a higher dynamic range, low order filter, or a sloppy or high order filter? Without going through the design. Of course, the details will differ. You can also, once you have IED, I also mentioned you can do the power consumption and assuming compression and be half the supply, you can calculate the dynamic range. You can do this as a paper exercise. Of course, we didn't do that in 95, but done it since. And it's a very good way of seeing your complexity. Is a generator equivalent to the same? Slightly different formulas, but it boils down to the conditions. And actually, this I did for the Bluetooth filters. We first made an elliptic filter with 10 poles, but we decided that was not worth it, so we reverted to 6-pole, 3 third order local prototype part of the filters that we implemented as bandpass filters for 3 megahertz. And that consumed 6 milliwatts. ADCs, similar. Here you can compare sampling capacitor with a quantization noise just to make a connection between capacitance size and noise. And then, of course, the number of bits, you get a dynamic range, which is the well-known formula, 6 times or 6.0. But in linear units, it's 1.5 times 2 to the 2m. That's your dynamic range, if you have m bits. And saying that your sampling capacitor, okay, to your C noise should be the same level as the quantizer noise, quantization noise, which is known to be a step squared over 12. And plug in the values, you can see, oh, I need this size sampling capacitor. Knowing that, you can figure out how much power you need to drive. Now, that gives you sort of the framework of a power consumption of an A2D converter. And that was published Kennington, I think. Also, then mapping how do A2Ds relate to this lower bound. And it turned out to be, if you think about noise figure, the power figure here, that's huge. It was 47 dB. Technology now has moved it down to some 42, but still it gives you the behavior and you can compare various A to D solutions. Now this actually leads up to what is called the Schreier figure of merit, which has the same, but this is one way of making that so the common figure of merit used by the decom motors look like this instead. I, being in radio, the Schreier form is more of interest, I think it's more applicable to us. But for very high speed and low resolutions, you see the Walden figure of merit also used. But this is highly interesting slide. This is taken from Professor Merman's from Stanford's collection of data from ICCC, VLSI, and some other sources. And to the left, at low Nyquist rates, and here the Nyquist rate is twice the signal bandwidth in case it's an oversound. The figure of merit sort of levels out just shy of 180 dB. And that's because it's noise limited. As you move up in bandwidth, figure of merit drops and you are more technology limited. So knowing where your application is in this range, you can figure out, okay, I can make such and such an A to D converter without designing it. And recognizing that one bit costs four times the power. You can do estimates, trade-offs between filter complexity and A-to-D resolution. But as you move above this breakpoint, you will lose the noise property and performance drops quickly. This is why all high performance, very fast A-to-D converters more or less are timing delayed. Because you cheat, and instead of making a 1 gigahertz A-to-D, you make 20, 40 or some large number, much slower ones, and then multiplex. There is an overhead to that. But this breakpoint is shifting to the right with the scale and these techniques. It's an energy trend. So basically, if you want to know power consumption of an A-to-D, you can use a very simple formula, which is in linear units, it's a product of dynamic range and bandwidth. So you can try that. Now, with delta sigmas, they cheat because they have a super linear dynamic range improvement as bandwidth goes down, because you do not have to have the first order slope in the noise shape. For machine type communication, we're often talking very low powers. Now, of course, other applications. But you can also apply the same heuristic reasoning on power amplifiers. Usually, if you start with a saturated power, maximum output power, you need to back off to make headroom for your amplitude modulation of the signal. If it's a constant analog modulation, then you're free to run them into all compression. Based on that saturation point, you can actually figure out, assuming a cubic nonlinearity where IP3 is. And then an ideal push-pull, let's say, you can figure out the efficiency, and then the power consumption. So, by very simple tricks, you can get ballpark numbers. I mean, these are ballpark numbers, not exact. But the backoff depends both on the peak to average power ratio and your IN3 requirements. If you have very strict adjacent channel leakage ratio requirements, you may have to back off even more to get the sidebands down. And this is a model developed by Carvalho, where we have a wideband, white noise-like signal, like OFDM. And depending on the image, the IM3 and the back off, you can play around with how much EVM or AC law you get versus efficiency. And depending on which limit is strict on, you have to choose either peak to average power ratio. Of course, if you're making a high power PA, you will put much more effort into designing it and simulating it than this would apply digital pre-distortion. But this gives a connection between your power consumption, your linearity, for a simple device. So, to summarize the parameter dependencies, this is a matrix where we can see area, power, dynamic range, and ACPR or ACMR for the various kind of blocks. RF blocks tend to behave like LNAs, except the PA, they have this property that they are almost clipping all the time. LNAs, you don't want that. Baseband paths behave more like filters, and A-to-Ds are beats of their own, but the DAC is behaving similarly. And here you can see that, for example, to put gain in a low-pass filter is quite costly. you need to make headroom at the end for the maximum occupancy, and noise floor in the beginning for the lowest, which is perhaps a bit surprising. Otherwise, many of these relations are quite obvious. But the dynamic range remains the worst culprit, so trying to minimize that is a good thing. So, does some reading list if you didn't catch it all. So, with that, I think it's coffee time.